Today I'm going to talk about the basics of crypto, more so how does the blockchain work and what is the blockchain. Let's go through the brief history of the internet, right? So about 25 years ago, we started with the internet, and that's what we call Web 1.0. Now, Web 1.0 was pretty simple. You would have websites on the internet where you could list stuff. Basically, you could create a website for your company, for your shop, but you couldn't do much on that. You could just go on and take a look at what's in store. You could take a look at where you can find the shop, or you can find contact information, and that was it. It was basically like the Yellow Pages book, but on a computer. Now, a couple years later, we got to Web 2.0, which was earmarked by the arrival of social media. We could start creating interactive experiences. You could create web shops where you could browse and buy stuff, and you could interact with other people. You could upload pictures, connect with your friends. And then also bandwidth of the internet started to improve. We got 3G, 4G, now we have 5G. So we started having streaming services like Netflix. We started having video chats like FaceTime. So we started living our lives on the internet. Now, what that brought us was that a couple of companies became enormously huge. So companies like Google, now Alphabet, Facebook, now Meta, companies keep renaming themselves these days, they started amassing a lot of data about your life. Because of that, they started having a lot more control over what you can do or what you cannot do. And I'm pretty sure that you've also read a bunch of news about people being logged out of their Google accounts and that resulting in basically being logged out of their entire digital lives. Same goes with the financial world. The moment Web 2.0 arrived, internet banking became a thing. Today, you can log into your internet banking account, you can manage your finances online, and the amount of money that was transferred over the internet also exploded, which also gave banks a lot more power. Now, that means that centralized players within any industry, through the development of the internet, through Web 2.0, they became enormously powerful. And you and me, as regular internet users, we lost control over our digital lives. Now, that changed when Web 3.0 arrived, when cryptocurrencies arrived. And that is why we're talking about how blockchain works. The technology itself exists to solve this power imbalance, solve the issue of centralization through the means or by the means of decentralization. So as I said, everything is about data and how data is stored and how data is managed. In a centralized environment, you have a database and one player controls and owns all the data. In a decentralized environment, on the blockchain, what happens is that everybody owns the data. Everybody controls the data together. Not a single person has more authority over what happens to the data. And by data, I mean what you can do on a social media platform or, as it started, how and where you can send or receive money from. In technical terms, what happens is that, let's say you have a bank account, but a bank account runs on the blockchain, a Bitcoin wallet, for example. You store your money on a Bitcoin wallet. In a banking world, only you and your bank would know what's on it. In a decentralized blockchain environment, those information are stored on the blockchain on a public ledger. Now, what that means, every single person who contributes to the maintenance of the blockchain will know how much money you have on your Bitcoin wallet. And also, they will need to prove, they will need to validate if you send money from A to B, that transaction actually happened, you actually had that amount of money. Let's see an example. So I want to send $1,000 to you. If I send it to your bank account, what happens is that I send a note to my bank saying, David sends $1,000 to person B. So my bank will take a note saying, David has minus $1,000, person B has plus $1,000. Now, the bank takes that information and sends that information to person B's bank. And then that bank also clears that transaction saying, okay, David's bank account exists, I got the permission from David's bank, so I'm just gonna take that money from David's bank and I'm gonna deposit it into person B's bank. Four players. This process in the banking world is called the clearing process. The way it works on the blockchain though, is that I have a wallet address and I have your wallet address. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna send a note to the blockchain saying, I'm gonna send $1,000 worth of Bitcoin to person B's wallet address. And if I have the sufficient amount of Bitcoin on my wallet, basically I'm gonna broadcast that information to the blockchain. And then every validator will take a look one by one. They will take a look at my wallet address and your wallet address and do the exact same clearing process the bank does. However, there's not just one single person, but there are many of them. A transaction will only get cleared if at least 51% of the validators say that, yep, this happened. Why is this important? It's important because A, I don't have to trust you or trust the bank or trust the validators. I'm gonna get to that a bit later. And I don't have to get permission from anybody else. I don't have to get the permission from the bank or from your bank or from any authority. But the most important part is I don't have to trust that validators are not malicious. What does that mean? That means that you cannot cheat through the validation process, because let's say that there are 100 people who are validating this transaction. If there is one person who's gonna say, yeah, David doesn't have that kind of money, because they want to cheat, what will happen is that the other 99 will stand up and say, hold on a second, this information doesn't check out with our records. So think of the whole blockchain logic as a revolution of accounting, because it takes out the control of the hands of mega corporations. It gives the control back to the people that are using the technology, to the users. So in Web 2, you as the user, you're a product. You're not a user. In Web 3, you are a user because you control what happens to your money or what happens to your data. This is the true power of blockchain, and this is why this innovation has become incredibly, incredibly important.